Humanity emerged out of ignorance and fear in a hostile world that offered no answers. Religion has tried to fill that gap, and each successive religion has mostly been a critique or parody of what came before. Perhaps if God wanted to deliver a single profound message to all of humanity, he would have just wrote it on the moon, but he didn't. Zoroaster, Confucius, Buddha, Plato, Jesus, Muhammad, Guru Nanak, Martin Luther, Baha'u'llah, and L. Ron Hubbard were all critics of religion, products of their place and time. Each offered their own thoughts on how to live our lives and structure our societies, and that tradition continues. The difference today is the vast body of knowledge humanity has gained, which makes faith-based claims increasingly foolish. Biblical criticism began as early as the 16th century. It coincided with the Enlightenment, Reformation, and more widespread translations of the Bible. Before this, scripture was copied by hand, and a majority of people were illiterate anyway. Also, the Catholic Church controlled scripture and even the interpretation of it. Thanks to the printing press, however, it wasn't long before scholars began pointing out problems like the books of Moses must have had more than one author, contradictions, questionable translations, repetition of events, diverging accounts, and the Gospels of Jesus weren't written until at least 40 years after his death, but supposedly contain quotes. Eyewitness accounts today are considered unreliable, not enough for conviction. In this case, we are talking about divine messages and supernatural events, but we don't even have reliable second-hand accounts. Einstein stated he believed in the God of Spinoza, meaning he was a deist. Specifically, he described himself as a pantheist, or agnostic. He said the idea of a personal God was childish. Bertrand Russell described religion as superstition and criticized any ideology that suppressed knowledge. He said that he was agnostic because he couldn't prove God did not exist, but he should be thought of as an atheist. His argument for atheism is known as Russell's teapot, which he uses to show that the burden of proof is on the person making the claim. If he claimed there was a teapot orbiting the sun between the Earth and Mars, which was too small to be seen by telescopes, and he had no proof it existed, there wasn't any reason for people to believe it, even though he couldn't be proven wrong. Variations of Russell's teapot have been used to make the same point. Some have even been turned into parody religions. One claims that God is really a goddess in the form of an invisible pink unicorn. It is logical to say it is invisible because we can't see it, but if you have faith it is a pink unicorn, no one can prove you wrong because it's invisible. The Flying Spaghetti Monster is the most popular version, called Pastafarianism. It was created by Bobby Henderson in 2005 to protest the teachings of intelligent design in Kansas public schools alongside evolution. He demanded that schools also teach that an undetectable flying spaghetti monster created everything after getting drunk. Instead of being filled with the spirit, you are touched by his noodly appendage. Instead of yarmulkes or turbans, you might wear a pasta strainer. Instead of the Ten Commandments, there are the eight I'd really rather you didn'ts. Pirates, octopuses, and pasta sauce are highly revered, in addition to basically all forms of pasta. Despite being an internet and international sensation, Pastafarianism has so far been rejected as a religion by multiple governments. Other parody religions include the Church of the Subgenius, which claims a 1950s fictional salesman named J.R. Bob Dobbs became a prophet after an alien deity named J.H.V.H.1 revealed through a television that a massive conspiracy was at the root of all other conspiracies preventing humans from achieving slack, which must be capitalized but is never really defined, though probably means achieving goals without effort. And finally, John Oliver's Our Lady of Perpetual Exemption, which was an actual church created to highlight the predatory and hypocritical behavior of the prosperity gospel and televangelist, as well as show how easy it is to establish a church in the US and solicit donations tax-free. He called money seeds, but he specifically wanted money, not seeds. Other criticisms are aimed at Christianity's obsession with capitalism. Buddy Jesus from the movie Dogma was a rebranded, kid-friendly image of Jesus with a smile, a wink, and a thumbs up that replaced Jesus on the cross. Others kept the cross, but instead of Jesus, one shows a crucified Santa and another, called Mick Jesus, shows a crucified Ronald McDonald. Shortly after the second millennium, when it became clear religious fundamentalists would continue to plague society, criticism of religion adopted a sense of urgency. Rather than simply making the case for being agnostic or atheist, critics became anti-theist, attacking the very morality of religion itself more openly and strongly than ever before, most notably the authors known as the Four Horsemen. Daniel Dennett wrote Breaking the Spell and described religion as a natural phenomenon that should be studied scientifically. He imagines a hypothetical future when the Vatican is a museum and Mecca is a Disney theme park. Richard Dawkins wrote The God Delusion to stress that the truth of the universe as discovered through science and supported by evidence is more awe-inspiring than any belief system accepted on faith. He says, just because religion provides consolation doesn't make it true, and it is more honorable to live a life in pursuit and acceptance of reality. Sam Harris wrote The End of Faith to point out that being certain about anything without evidence is harmful to society, but we give religion a pass because it's so ingrained in our culture. He says that science and religion make competing claims about reality and therefore are not compatible. Christopher Hitchens wrote God is Not Great, How Religion Poisons Everything, and defended his subtitle saying, religion attacks our basic integrity by claiming without a totalitarian celestial father whom we must love and fear, we would not know right from wrong. He toured the most religious parts of the U.S., passionately defending separation of church and state and the morality that is innate in us from childhood. He condemned religious organizations for lying to children for centuries while abusing them physically and emotionally in the interest of perpetuating an ignorant and servile population. He attacked all religions unapologetically, but especially the morality of the New Testament. Not until gentle Jesus, meek and mild, he often said, do we get eternal torture just for what we think, the definition of totalitarianism. Where you go? I suppose.